Scott, maybe we can
just dive right
gears.
In.
Yeah. Let's dive in.
All right, so let's talk about a natural frequency. Well, natural frequency by definition is the frequency at which a system naturally vibrates once it's been forced into motion.
A free body diagram. It's like we're back in school again.
That's right. So if we look at this free body diagram, like Keith mentioned, we have an equation to determine the natural frequency based on the spring rate, K, and the mass, script M. So the natural frequency is equal to the square root of K over M.
Yeah, it's not that damping doesn't exist, right? It's just not part of the equation for natural frequency.
Exactly. If we look at this free body diagram, and you can see on the top portion here, we have the displacement or the response, and on the bottom, we have the input force. So we input a constant level force into the system. We can look at the relative motion between the mass and the base at different frequencies. And if we're below the resonance, you can see the mass and the base are moving in phase with each other, and the response is equal to the input. At the resonant frequency, we have a phase change, and now the mass and the base are 90 degrees out of phase. The response is much greater than the input, and we get that highest amplitude right there on the natural frequency. Once we cross that resonant frequency, we're now 180 degrees out of phase. The response level actually comes down. It's now lower than the input force, but there's not this exaggerated response. So how do we determine the resonant behavior of a structure? Well, we want to put a force into that structure, and we want to measure the response. And when we perform this type of test by putting in a force and measuring the response, we can use those inputs and outputs to determine what we call FRFs. And the equation for that FRF is shown here, where we have the output divided by the input. When I input a force, I usually want to use a quick impulse. And you can see, based on a time axis here on the x-axis in the lower left, if I highlight that here for you, you can see here this is time and force input, and I just have a really quick impulse. Then I measure the response at the accelerometers that I have on my structure, and that will give me the FRFs I'm going to look at. The reason we use that brief input in the time domain is when I perform an FFT on that type of signal, I'll get this very broad, kind of equal force excitation across a broad band of frequency. And that's kind of highlighted here more on this next slide, where we look at some different waveforms. So if I have a sine wave, it's very specific when I perform an FFT to look at that in the frequency domain. It's just one specific frequency at a given amplitude. If I have a damped transient, the waveform in the frequency domain is shown there. Same for a square wave. But what we really want to highlight is that impulse event. So if I have a quick impulse in the time domain, when I look at that same signal in the frequency domain, it's an equal excitation across a broad range of frequency. And we want this equal excitation.
So Scott, I think that makes sense. I mean, you have a structure, it's not doing anything just sitting there, but we want to identify what the resonant frequency is, so we have to excite it. But you don't know up front where it's at.
Yeah, so I don't want to excite just one resonant frequency.
Right, so by hitting it in a narrow impulse hammer impact, let's call it a hammer impact, you're going to simultaneously excite a broad frequency range, and then whatever the resonances are, they'll expose themselves. Right?
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So once I get these FRFs, well, what can they tell me? Well, we can list that out for you here. I'll get the resonant frequency information like we've discussed so far. I'll also get some damping information, and we'll talk more about that. And then with multiple FRFs, I can look at the phase information, and I can look at the relative phase across multiple measurement locations to see how the structure is moving. So I can look at the peaks, I can see the resonant frequencies or the natural frequencies of this given structure that we're showing on the left-hand side. And because there's multiple points measured within this geometry, I can look at the relative phase information for each of those points to determine if I've got a torsion mode, a bending mode, or a second torsion mode as I go through each resonant frequency for the given structure. So in other words, a structure is going to have more than one resonant frequency, but at each one of those frequencies, it's going to have a different mode shape that I can determine using multiple FRFs. Let's talk about damping. So here we have two free body diagrams, one with damping and one without damping. And when I set those two bodies in motion, you'll notice that the structure with damping returns back to kind of a stationary position at a faster rate than the structure on the left. And that's because it has higher damping, meaning it's almost like a suspension on your automotive vehicle. If you were to hit a bump without suspension, it'd be more jarring. You'd have more of this motion that you're seeing on the left versus the damping provided by the suspension that we can see and how that calms the structure back down. So if we look at the Q factor is one way that we can describe whether a system is heavily or lightly damped. And to determine the Q factor, that method is shown here. I can look at the peak of my resonant frequency and use this 3 dB method, or the 3 dB down method, to get the intersection points of F2 and F1, and then I can calculate Q. You can see that if the peak on the right-hand side is sharper, that Q value is higher, meaning it's lightly damped. To determine that, especially in test lab, it's really easy. Within test lab, we have an active picture that I can click on this graph, and I can add a cursor, and I can slide that to a peak. I can right click on that cursor, say calculations, and I could calculate this Q factor. You'll notice there's some other calculations for damping as well, shown here. And we'll talk about those in a minute and how they're related to Q factor. But I can simply slide this cursor to each resonant frequency to determine what those damping values are at each resonant frequency. When I click off, that information can stay there as well.
Do you need a license of Test Lab to be able to do this in PowerPoint?
You do not need a license of Test Lab to do that. It's actually a free plugin that you can download from our site, Keith. So going back to the presentation, to see how these damping values are related, you can see that the loss factor is related to the Q factor or damping factor, and the damping ratio is also related. So these equations are all related. It's just different ways of describing the damping value or the damping percentage, let's say, of a given resonant frequency within my structure. Okay?